Caleb, the floor is yours.
Hello, hi. Hello, everyone. It's really good to be here. I think it's good to continue with gratitude, as to be here today, it's taken so many people who have like worked together to make this a reality. So I want to say thank you to everyone. Thank you. And also the reading circle. That was such a rich conversation. And at times when like you are writing in your room and the world is very small and immediate, it always blows my mind that like something you have wrote has then taken you to a community in another country for you to have a conversation about this thing that you're writing. It's always a phenomenal idea, especially during the lockdown. The idea of like literature felt very alien, especially this pocket of literature where you write something and you discuss it with people in a room or in a space, especially a nice sunny day like this. So thank you all for being here, essentially. I wrote this book, Poor, I guess between 2015 and 2020. And essentially, I think it's my life's work up to now, at least. And it centers around a community that has shaped me, community in North Peckham. But really, I think it's applicable to many spaces and many communities around the world. Anyone that is part of a community that can consider themselves underclass, that can consider themselves as part of the have-nots rather than the haves, I think has some sort of stake in this. Yeah. Shall we listen to some of these? So accompanying me with this is just a visual, I guess, companion to reading. This is just a small section of North Peckham Estate, and just to situate and give you an idea, if in case you haven't really either heard of North Peckham Estate or really got a proper feel for it, this is it. And the people that you've seen here are just like people that, when I arrived in this estate, I was 7 years old, and these are the people that ended up being the foundation to who I am today. Yeah. This is called Because of the Times. Oh, right. To give you a proper sort of understanding of North Peckham Estate, it was 65 multi-story complex that was connected with these walkways from one block to another block. And it kind of went on for about 2 miles, I think. And essentially, it was on a 40-acre site, and there was like 1,444 homes in it. So I think at the time, it was the largest in Europe. Words can't really describe the vastness of this space. And I was 7 years old when I arrived, and it swallowed me up physically and metaphorically. This is Because of the Times. Brown and gold and stretched like the slurring of a toothless drunk. Sweet neighborhood talk coined it a mega estate. Your flat was in the north, one bedroom and seven bodies making do. You told yourself that it was a small alcove set beyond the reach of the clock's hands. On Mondays, the detergent they used to clean the stairs smelt of bubblegum. So you would walk through the corridors that connected one block to another block, one joy to another joy, a system of nerves, a casing of sand and endless windows. Is this what the architect had in mind? A paradise of affordable bricks tucked under a blanket shielded from the world. Were that hopeful goods on powder blue paper, measured lines defining angles of respite for the poor? What foresight he had to put shops and laundrettes on the estate so mothers could send their children on errands, knowing that even if they walked a mile, their thorny ankles wouldn't set foot on open ground to be lost to the city's clutches or feel the affliction of rain. And how quickly the rain dried, how loudly bricks hummed again as you went back to your life, your tinkering, your blooming, your making do. Nothing this estate raised was a monster, yet the devil found good ground to plow his seeds. Gabos, the widening gyre, residents on the brink, washed, wrung, walking shrines, asking questions to which the architect maintained that their design was a good solution because of the times. And it's true, on paper, there were no designs for a tomb. Yet the East Wing stairs was where Damilola was found. Blue dawn, blue body, blue lights, blue tape. I'm gonna try and read something that we didn't read in the circles, but to be fair, some of the good ones. I might read 13 at some point. I always find myself reading that. Cool. Barter. Give me your face and I'll give you mine. Give me your benefit of the doubt and I'll give you my doubt of innocence. Give me your milk and I'll give you my sand. Give me your neat nails and I'll give you my exoskeleton. I think I know where to find my mother's mother's kin, scattered like dust mite in the wind. If I gather them all, will you take them and give me your pristine family tree? The steely chic of my block is nice this time of the year. You're welcome to stay there. If I can stay in your home, I mean your small holiday home in Costa Blanca. Once I pulled my tonsil out of my mouth using my thumb and my index finger. I was reaching for my voice box. I rarely use it to its full potential. I would say its condition is nearly brand new. Take it for when you want to rap hip hop songs. I am a superhero with the power of invisibility. The problem is, I haven't quite got the handle of it yet. At the worst times, I am invisible. At the worst times, I am visible. I love the girl so much, it eroded my skin. I loved her until she swelled to her brink. I loved her so much that one night during sex, I cried and my tears filled up to the ceiling. And she, not being able to swim, drowned. Also, I find that such a hilarious poem, by the way. Absolutely hilarious for many reasons. Okay. This is survivor's guilt. And so I slipped through the cracks. Can't tell you how it was done. The plain act of drawing breath each time, dubbing alternative endings for myself until my presence at funerals felt like bragging. Run over, twice, stabbed, shot, in a car crash. I'm a museum of all the ghosts I could have been. Why me when better boys deserve life, when better mothers deserve living sons? I have sung the chorus of revenge at the red dusk. Lord, if you be at all, be a blade. If not, the man then will do what we must. Though we bow our heads, it cannot be for shame. Gang signs or prayers, what one cannot solve, surely the other one will. My fingers are bilingual like that. Gun fingers get raised in a dance, we bust shots up in the clouds. Angels get hit and fall like loose feathers. Sometimes the man them forget and aim into the crowd. Each dawn, I wake up and scroll myself for new scars. Confess that I want to live for good times. Picnic with a painting, kiss her on the grass. But every day on the ends, there's a profession my breathing body mocks. I think what's really fascinating about writing or having a book out is because there are so many drafts And in your head, you remember all the different drafts. And sometimes I waver and read older versions out loud. I have a track record. For some reason, I've lived all over London, but I seem to always end up in relationships with women from South London. There's just something about that. I don't know, maybe it's the water. October is a strange month. The sun dies and leaves behind fire petals, and you emerge in the slickest finger waves. What I would give to see you every night in my dreams, coiling your lower back like stems slipping around slips of rays, stopping traffic stopping. I'm able to describe the setting to the night architect who builds my dreams. October sunset as a burning bruise. But of you, I whisper memory and bronze, and a really long syllable I lose to the tax of waking. I say you are unafraid. I say you are a roof, one made of mosaics, covering a palace somewhere. I play my favorite natural sound, sliced plantain stuttering in oil. I say, that's it. That's everything I have. Now build me a dream, looping of October's quenching tongue, and of her who can't be made again in the best work of the night. We talked about my dad earlier. Felt like a therapy session in some way. We have a very interesting relationship. Actually, you know what? Concrete. So I have a much of this, actually, much of the poems in this center around or touch. Either center or end up touching around concrete. And concrete as a material in my built environment was one that was a lot more impactful than I actually realized. I think anyone who ends up really living in the inner city or just like in a space where concrete is very dominant. I mean, actually it was Norwegian brutalism that really drawed my attention to how much concrete is present in my living memory. There's so much of my memory involves concrete. And there are so many people that I've met over sort of the last few years who don't have that same relationship because they've just either grown up in a rural area or just in a space where concrete hasn't been such an impact or hasn't been such a presence in their life. And I always find that interesting. And just marking how my relationship with concrete, for better or for worse, is one that I found really interesting when looking at the architectural preoccupations of the book. Concrete, 4. When everyone called me the son of a shadow, it was concrete that called me proof of light. Behind my block, Keisha said that she liked Ashton. My legs gave way and I sunk into the wall. For a brief moment, I was the marrow of concrete, marking my pain there against this texture. When I was younger, I played with Ashton. We drew the future in chalk and hopscotch, goalposts, faces. That was when I felt safe on concrete. At least the devil couldn't breach the ground. And I wish once again to be haunted by a simpler agent. Back then, I knew who and what I hated and love. Now concrete has made an equilibrium of me. I am no more a good insulator. I don't hold on to the hate or Keisha's scent or my own chest. Come winter, the wind will pass through me. It will pass like notes through the clef of a sugared song, like sound through an ear that won't hear. Coping. I mean, one of like my biggest angst with this collection is because there's so much celebration in it, but I think when I look at the balance of like celebration and enjoyment and all the good things that comes out of this community, I don't think is equally weighted with all the grief and all the like more difficult things to contemplate when you are living in a community that is structurally deprived in many areas. And I guess it's just one of the symptoms, losing people through poor health, through crime, through one way or the other, physically losing people and also like losing people because the spark in their eye dies and they become someone else. How do you cope with that? This is called coping. Dark-skinned boys scare everything in the dark, though really we're just trying to scare away the dark. Round here, this is how we greet each other. What's good, my G? As if to say, are you safe, my G? Isn't this how you would call out to your friends if you too was in a dark place, standing on the edge of a ledge? Shout out to us boys who play out here. God knows how we do it. Or maybe God doesn't know. Maybe an estate, tall as it is the half-buried femur of an old god, and a blue light of dawn, his son, looking on at the things we do when there is one less boy amongst us. How we pour the Holy Spirit of the bottle onto the concrete where his ashes lie. Stir it into a clay, mold it into a new body, and like a kite in fading wind, watch his soul return back to his body like he never left. Isn't this what you would do for your friends if you too was in a dark place, standing on the edge of a ledge? So after we finished the discussion in the reading circle, I realized that I wrote a poem in Sweden that ended up being in the collection called Trauma is a Warm Bath. Trauma is a warm bath. Just ask the boy who carries anger on his shoulders like two cannons. Blastoise bold, hardened like old eyes that know how wasteful it is to cry in a drought. Who took another boy's life at a funeral. Often he would tell the shiny version to a girl who cornrowed his hair on her living room floor. She would hear of how he pulled the trigger easy, like turning off a bathroom light switch. She knew there was too much theater in his voice, decided to run him a bath and told him, when you can no longer shrug that day away, the bosom of a warm bath will see you through. Just ask the paramedic at the scene. He knew the body was shoebox empty, but all his training didn't tell him what to do when a boy gets shot at a funeral and the crowd are unwilling to ration bowed heads between two dead bodies. How bizarre it is to give CPR to a vacant body for 30 minutes. His sorriest apology. Just ask the mother who worked until her hands curled like boiled crabs to have a son on safer shores, fed him, bought him toothpaste for 2 decades almost. Who would get a call to say that she had birthed her son into a casket after all. Just ask the boy writing this poem, who feels like death is a party all his friends were invited to but him, who scribbles the name of his dead friend on paper. He thinks the paper is a Ouija board. He thinks a poetry reading is a seance. What a farce, expecting the dead to speak in the voice of the living. All right, let's do one more then. I think. So you see, it's such an interesting thing, this thing that we call life and this connection that we have with a space and the logic, or maybe the defying of the logic of being in a space that could kill you. And loving that space. It's such an interesting idea when we think about home and not necessarily, I think it's something that kind of translates in all manners of our understanding of home. Home can be something that is, we're so deeply connected to, despite that place being a place that harms us. Whether it's like a domestically living within a space, like within your immediate family, and it not being the best space for you, physically, mentally, or whatever, but you still have an affinity and a connection to that space, or country. That was such a nice prefix to what I was going to read, but now I've forgotten what I was going to read. We will not all fight like dogs at our deaths. I was reading this, I can't remember what book it was particularly, but it was by an architect who was talking about our connection with home and home being, I'll read this and then I'll finish that sentence. I have never loved anything the way that I love the ends. On a good day, not necessarily a sunny one, I whisper wicked things in its ear, charge the air with electricity. Auntie said she knew by the way I played with the other kids I would grow to be a jealous lover. I'm not yet grown, and I have chosen to love something nobody wants to love, that nobody can truly be loved by. I'm on course to defy Auntie's prediction. I know this much, we're all gonna die in this dunya. But if anything should kill me, let it be the starchy base of pasta in front of the yard food shop. Let it be the piercing mutter of mandem on pedal bikes grating against brick walls. Yes, it's strange to order your own death like takeaway. I have never spoken to my father about love. If I did, I imagine his advice would be this: learn to love what everyone sees as ugly. Isn't that the ethos of love in all tragedies? Toxic, ritualistic, taxing of at least one of every two lives? Yet, I dance this terrible dance of love, surrendering myself to the pulse of street lamps. To die for the dust of your land is purest. We will not all fight like dogs at our death. Some of us will lay on the grass, green like in the cartoons, shoeless, and with our arms out held for love's embrace. We're always, our primary preoccupation, I think I'm paraphrasing, he said it in a much more intelligent way than I'm about to. But like, one of our preoccupations as human beings is to belong, and is to feel like we are in something's path, present. Someone says hello to you, you're in their path. They recognize your existence. And when you can feel that without words, that thing could be considered as home. And if that thing can define you at your most base level, then there is a romance in that thing leading to your demise as well. He said it in a much better way than I did. But I remember reading that, and then I wrote that poem. There's a lot of conversation about why the underclass are so preoccupied with home, even though they don't own it. You know what I mean? Why do you guys care about a space that you don't even own? And I guess it's that, really. It's that unspoken connection. Anyway, this has been really nice. Thank you guys for listening to me.
Thanks, Caleb. Really nice, great selection. I don't think we got through all of them in our in our reading circle. There were a couple.
Yeah. There's a lot of poems in here, so we're always going to be spot for choice.
Yeah, ironically, you've titled the book Poor, but there's an abundance of material within it.
Yeah, you know, I love to play on that irony.
I was thinking, just as a kind of general introduction, mm-hmm. it'd be really nice to kind of extend into your biography.
Yes.
Just to get a sense of where you started writing, mm-hmm. how you started writing, how it also was kind of manifested in the kind of spaces that you existed in.
Yeah.
And the kind of impact of those spaces too. So maybe, yeah, kind of start with your biography a bit.
So I guess like the first time that I really recognized that I had a love for writing was when I was in school, and I realized I was very disruptive as a student. I'd finished most of my GCSEs by the time, 2 years early. I'd taken them right from year seven. We had a school that was it was a terrible school. And by the time you get to your final year to do the big exams, most students just weren't there anymore. So in order to make up the shortfall and at least on paper make the school look like it's functioning, they would get all the younger years right from your first year to take the final tests. And if you were lucky enough or intelligent enough, then you would have them very early. So it was during that time that I realized that, oh, actually, this is a way for me to finish school early. And then by the time I'm 14, 15, I can just not be here. I can go off and do other things. And then it sort of developed into music. At the time, there was a real grime music or garage music at the time was a big thing at those pirate radio stations. And because, you know, I was 13, 14 with a disinterest with school, me and my friends used to go off and do that. And it was such a nice way of writing. I preferred the writing of it than actually the performing of it. And at the time, I used to listen to the radio. There was no you couldn't look up, you know, how the internet was, you know, dial up. Can't just Google the lyrics or something. You had to play it, stop, right? Do you know, you remember cassettes? Yeah, I know some of you are trying to move Gen Z. There's no Gen Z here, or there's probably one or two, maybe two. But everyone else should be nodding. You guys know tape? Yeah, thank you, come on. So yeah, it was just how laborious that was to learn lyrics in that way. And that made me really pay attention to what was being said. I remember Oasis or Dr. Dre or The Streets and all just having to write those lyrics because I want to learn it and going to school the next day and act like I know it, you know? So I guess through that, there was a real affinity to language. But it wasn't until many, many years later, I was in university and we're doing this poetry module. And before on our first week, my lecturer was everyone has to write a poem and come in the second lecture. And she would pick random people to come and read it in front of, you know, 300 of us. And the logic behind that, by the way, was you can't really be a critique of poetry without you understanding the nature of poetry and how it sets itself apart from other forms of literature. Critique in poetry was vastly different from critiquing any other novels or whatever, which was her logic, which actually in a way kind of made sense because once... And my number was pulled up. We all had to take a raffle. And I'm incredibly unlucky with winning. I've never won a raffle before. So, and the student next to me, she wins raffles all the time. So she said, let's swap. And hopefully we can see who has the stronger, yeah, who has the stronger fortune. And yeah, her fortune translated to me, and I had to read it in front of 300 people. And then it just ignited something in me. And I guess, yeah, from then on, it was just like writing poetry. And sometimes if there's like an open mic, I might go and like read there. I was a teacher for a bit. I taught like secondary school, sixth form. And a lot of the time when I'm teaching a poetry module, I always encourage my students to write poetry. And I mentioned this kid, very cocky kid back in the day in my class, and he would always challenge me to do what I expect the class to do. So in that way, I had to start putting that into practice a lot more. And then, yeah, before you know it, like, one thing leads to another thing, to another thing, and you meet, like, I met Terence Hayes, Ilya Kaminsky, Natalie Teitler, Roger Robinson, these like people that whose poetry I used to read, and see, meeting them in real life and them sort of nurturing writing in me, that's kind of how it all ended up being what it is.
But then was there I'm kind of interested in the kind of background in grime music too. I mean, you were a scripter there, writer. Yeah. Performer to some degree within that.
Yeah, performer, loosely.
So, but how did that? Did you ever read that as poetry, as such?
Yeah, you know, like I really and slyly still can. Like, poetry is such a. At the time, I just felt like it wasn't cool to say it was poetry, and I had to do it in the context of what was cool, and grime. Like, to be on grime, like on pirate radio, was like being on MT. Do you know, it was like the big thing. Like, people at school tuned in. You were a celebrity overnight. You know, like, influencers don't even know the real, like, surge. The real, it was like, when, before, like, proper internet, if, like, 50 people knew you, come on, you know the adrenaline rush that would give you? That was enough. That lasted for years.
Yeah, but let's go.
So I didn't necessarily see myself. I didn't necessarily want to accept that it was poetry or it was literature or anything like that because of my relationship with school and my introduction with poetry.
Yeah, and I want to kind of go back to something you said, pick up on a term, this idea of kind of structurally deprived, and bringing grime in that because grime is essentially about structure.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, the beats and bars structure, what you can fit in within that structure. But at the same time, it's a structure that's in relationship to another structure. So the verticality of how you can communicate, how you can mediate the music. So you have to use high-rise buildings as a way to put pirate radio aerials up. Yeah. So there's a kind of relationship between that. But there's also this idea of kind of being structurally deprived is kind of interesting also in relationship to that.
Yeah. And even looking taking an academic lens to like the form that we had to write in and how it really prepared me to write sonnets and to write like all these other very traditional poetic forms. And then also realizing that also that structure isn't just about the page, it's also about the community that gets to control what then is seen as poetry and what isn't seen as poetry and who's allowed in to the club and who's not allowed into the club. And I've found lots of parallel with grime and that later on, in many years later. Yeah, so I recognise what you're saying.
Yeah, and there's also very much a kind of brilliant connection to the book Poor there.
Yeah.
I mean, grime music is a really kind of situated way of speaking about one's experience within a built environment.
Yes.
Comes back to the kind of idea of structure. But maybe actually you can use this moment to say a little bit about the kind of underlying themes of Poor, because as a book, it's had a kind of quite a interesting reception, especially within the UK. Mm. It's kind of recently really been picked up by the architectural community, their artists kind of reading it. So maybe you can say something about the kind of the initial ideas of what themes would drive it, and then how that was kind of received.
I think I wanted it to just pose a question, and it was really about the design of social housing in London or in inner cities, in these communities. I just wanted to ask a question and to explore that. How is the correct term? I know it's such a loaded term, psychogeography. I don't know if there's any, like, can we include this in psychogeography, or does this stay within the remit of like psychological architecture? This is a question for you.
All right.
You're probably the most qualified. The two of you are the most qualified, because I've had so much conversations with architects, right from like the Royal Institution, the RIBA,
yeah,
to like architectural firms, to architectural students, and everyone seems to have like their own sort of idea of like how to coin the themes of the book. For me, psychogeography probably is the most accurate, my understanding of it. How does the design of this space, or how does this space impact the lives of the mental state, the physical state, the psychological state of the people that live there? How has it contributed to their everyday lives and to the events that have happened to them? So that's kind of was the sort of lead-in entry into it. I think then we sort of looked at like how this community is affected adversely, but also how they live their lives in spite of everything, how are they just normal, how do they have good times, how do they celebrate themselves, how do they come together to mourn tragic times. And then I guess everything just led into looking at one sort of rabbit hole. It led me down so many different rabbit holes, looking at religion, both on a personal level, but also like on a community-wide level, grief, mourning, celebration, love, because much of it is coming from like my early teen years and just like trying to figure out, like all teenagers do, this idea of like love. And you know, for the first time you're having these intense feelings for not just people but like spaces as well. Like I remember being 15 and having such a, like my identity was centered around being from Peckham, you know, that was central to me because it was the only thing that made sense in the context of the world that we were living in. I didn't quite feel all the way British. I didn't feel all the way Nigerian. I didn't feel like I was included in any conversations structurally, but I'm included in the conversations of what happens to that bin that's on that side of the estate, or what happened yesterday when this neighbor and that neighbor had a dispute. Or like, you know, like I felt like I was able to be, I was a participant, like I mattered if I could affect the world around me in a way that I didn't feel like I could just go and have a chat with the Prime Minister about some issues, or whether I could even vote, and whether voting meant anything, or whether people actually even cared about what was going on in my community.
I suppose one way then to think about psychogeography, and it's a kind of, there's no singular way of talking about that, but maybe in this case we could talk about it as a kind of method, as a method from moving from the plan, from the looking down onto to something that's kind of more street level, is to find a way of kind of reading at that level and reading and going back to structure, reading the kind of hidden structures within that and being able then to kind of articulate that in some way.
There you go.
Okay. just another thing about the book before I kind of get into some of the other questions that I want to do. Could you maybe say something about the format of the book? So there's, and as we kind of touched upon in the reading circle, there's, it's a book of text and it's a book of images.
Yeah.
They're given the license to be themselves.
Yeah.
They're not necessarily put into service of each other. But there's also a really kind of generative space in between them. It kind of really allows an audience to think in between those spaces. Maybe also kind of going back to the kind of structure to kind of look at these kind of patterns. And but also I think that there's a kind of opening of the kind of an aperture within that that includes not just kind of poetry in its kind of really formal sense, but you know, you bring in diary entries. There are kind of lines from songs in there. They're included, but maybe you can say something about the kind of format.
Yeah, I mean, I really wanted to question form in this. As someone who felt outside of, like always on the peripherals of like academia. Like I was invited in as a critic, I was invited in as a literature student, but in terms of the actual writing, it was never truly accepted into the canon of like poetry or British poetry anyway. And I always thought about this idea of like, what are we actually contributing? When we think about where we are now as a society, as humanity, we stand on the shoulders of what has come before so much. Like when we look at like the sonnet and when we look at different forms of like of or coined or cliched or things that have turned into cliches or understanding of like what something should be, it's always one that looks back and never looks forward of what something can be. And I felt like I wanted to really free myself from expectations of like what a poetry collection looks like, what form it takes. As someone who has always, or I guess my love for poetry came from the abstract or came from outside of our sort of normal understanding of like how you become a poet or how you get into it. I wanted to just look for the poetry of things and not necessarily the poetry of poems. Hence, diary entries, bits of bad scripts are in there, just various forms of like things that feel poetic, including images. We talked about that earlier on. I think that the pen and the lens do very similar things. They're both capturing a perspective, a moment in time. In a way, they're quite precognitive. They can also map out what the future looks like. They're trying to tell a story. So so those similarities were quite nice and kind of meant that they could live in the same space. They do those things in very different ways. Images, you know, they sort of bypass words. And where I feel words and therefore poems fail, I felt like the images were able to plug something new or at least, in spite of what is lost, there is something else here that could maybe suffice. So that was kind of why those, like everything was put in the way that it was put in. But essentially overall, I think that in the same way that we don't really necessarily, like my community has always defined itself on its own terms, despite the fact that it's in the news often, and there is a sort of, the media has like created a particular perceptions of my community. You go to those communities and they define themselves separately, and almost independently of like what everyone else sees from the outside. And I felt like that was an interesting lesson for me to take in to sort of creating a collection. It just needed to feel like the community. It needed to adhere to the community's rules and not necessarily the understanding of like poetry and how it should be presented to the world.
Maybe this is a kind of slight spoiler alert, and I hope you might get the chance to read this poem, but I'm going to kind of refer back to one of your kind of brilliant poems that I've been using quite a lot and referring back to, which is A Designer Talks of Home, A Resident Talks of Home. And this also kind of gets to the kind of crux of this kind of session and this kind of invitation for you around how your practice provides kind of alternative ways for reading and understanding how our material environment gives kind of shape to experiences. And kind of referring back to my kind of opening talk, something that you said on a podcast that's kind of really stuck with me, and this idea of like too many public futures are decided in private rooms.
Did I say that?
Yeah, I think I picked up.
Wow. That sounded so nice when you said it earlier on. I was like, whoever said that.
Really, that was you.
That was me.
Yeah, I'm kind of paraphrasing you. Anyhow,
but I'm really earning my keep then, yeah. Isn't it? That's quite nice.
So within this poem, you talk about, you've actually, kind of going back to scripts, you've sliced two scripts together. One is of a designer imagining a building space utopia, and the other a resident outlining the lived experience of the building, this space and this utopia. And so by slicing these two together, there's this kind of interesting flattening of time. Yeah? One that brings together designing, which is the architect, the vision of the designer, and that of the designed, the resident. So the conversation suggests not only the right to design, but maybe the right not to be designed too, through somebody else's ideas, utopias, and visions. So I would also say that this is almost unique in terms of writing about our built environment. This idea of kind of collapsing time between different futures, different pasts, and different presents, in a way that actually is very meaningful and educational. Could you say something about that kind of collapsing of the time and all of the kind of background to that poem?
Yeah, no, I feel as someone who constantly still sees, you know, Grenfell. So if you guys don't know, Grenfell was this tragedy that happened where the cladding of a building, the building that coats one of the estates, was caught on fire. Well, actually, the fire started from inside, but as it spread and caught the cladding on the outside, it just essentially, the building went up in flames. You know, officially, they said 72 people died. It's more closer to about 300 people. But because a lot of people are unregistered, a lot of people are immigrants, a lot of people don't have definitive papers to say they exist in a country, then, you know, bureaucracy can vanish them away to suit particular agendas. But yeah, I think when we think about the people in private rooms who decide on how a particular space should be designed and how people and their intentions behind how people should use it, there's always a disparity when it's working class spaces, when it's social housing, where it's like the implications of this is always a matter of life and death, and we always get it wrong. We seem to know how to get it right when it's less of a issue or less of a sort of consequence. They know how to design like airport lounges, and they want people to feel good and relaxed before they go on their flight, and important. And you go into an airport lounge, I don't know if you've been on, it's very nice, it does exactly that. You know, you walk into a private hospital and you immediately know you're gonna things. Well, there's this psychological thing where you think you're in safe hands. You walk into a like public hospital and you just like start to gear yourself up for the worst. It's design, isn't it? So what are the implications of making decisions that that center around people's lives? What are the implications of that? And how is it that these disparities always seem to most of the time center around working class, the working class? So who's having the conversation? Who's actually, where is the conversation between the architects and the people who are going to live in those spaces? Or at least where's the review? Because you could argue that, okay, for example, North Peckham Estate, it's huge, isn't it? When you look at that map, North Peckham Estate is really answering to the call in the 60s to rebuild the inner cities, et cetera, so therefore it was the correct design. But do we review that every 5-10 years if it still does its functionality? Because if I'm driving a car and after 5 years the car decides not to work in the way that I expect it to work, sometimes the brakes work, sometimes the brakes don't work. I'm not taking that out into the world. That's a matter of life or death. So you take your car to an MOT, you get it fixed, or you change your car, depending. Like, there isn't that thing. And if there is, it's always motivated by finance or politics, or in the case of cladding, you pick the cheaper cladding, you pick the one that, you know, someone higher up is married to someone and therefore it's in the best interest for that person's company. You know, all the games that feel like monopoly to the haves that end up being life or death to the have-nots. So I wanted to sort of collapse that conversation after, I'm not waiting for after the fact, I'm thinking about now, the immediacy of being able to create something, design something, and imagine a world where you can design something and like go into the future to see how that thing is working out and then come back and then like make adjustments. Ideally, that's what you'd want, innit?
yeah. Ideally.
Ideally.
Partly what I'm trying to suggest is that your writing is a kind of template for that, and maybe that the canon, the mainstream, the kind of center mm-hmm. of writing around our built environment, around architecture and design, mm-hmm. somehow is unable to write in that way.
Yeah, but then that would be a cop-out. Like, you have to be intelligent to be an architect. You have to be. Like, that is an easy way of letting them off the hook in that way, right? They know. Everything I'm saying is not new. Like, okay, an architect and or a firm should like be in touch with the people that like they're designing for, or should really think about that a lot more. Of course they do. And a lot of architects have like off the record like been like, well, it's just if it's not in the interest of that company, either profit margins or like whatever sort of relationship they need to keep, you know, especially when it's like you're contracted by the government, so you have to understand political discourse and what kind of that influences so many things that you can do. I'm just someone who's then putting it in a book and therefore like continuing the conversation that seems to be institutionally hushed or marginalized. Do you know what I mean? I think it would be a cop-out to infantile that industry by saying they haven't thought of that. Of course they have. They just don't care. If retribution was what the youths wanted, not one brick would still sit on this city skyline. We're over such theatrics for the time being. We browse through the catalogue of anarchy, underline moments in history and conclude that everyone just wants to go home. Who knew the streets were so frail to fall apart this easily? The youths run in all directions like scared cattle. Frightened animals are the most dangerous. to others and themselves. That's just basic zoology. The youths of today are cherry stems loaded in a magazine of a gun. The news, they say different. They say, us youths will come for you in a smaller than night. What we're really doing is making music, tweeting, Instagramming, unwrinkling nightlight from skin. One of us saw visions of a new home, a new world, new sky so blue it's black too. We're all sat around listening to him in tears. Utes, robbed of youth, robbed of a rocking cradle, singing the ballad of the youthful. If sorrow must come for us, let it collect us at our homes. I found it. So this was the final, this was the last poem that went into this collection. And if there is no other way, long live the jug. If Reese and them had a clean run, who knows what myth would have said about their jug. You know when the judge gave them 14 for the thing, the judge's son had to find a new dealer. Years before, they brought a white Christmas to the posh part of the city, 20 bricks in a Ghana Moss gold bag, enough to build a whole new borough. We christened them trap ministers. 9/11 changed wholesale prices for real, but the man them, they stayed afloat. Old trap legends teach us this buoyancy, how to become survivors of recessions, immune to the boom and bust, the bailiff's bark. What day isn't a headlock? There's like, when the, there's this idea of like the recession. My first real, like, the credit crunch, I don't know, was that called that here? What was the 2012? Or was just Sweden just like, you guys didn't experience, you floated through that. Congratulations. It wasn't, that was like my first understanding of a recession as an adult. It was my first adult recession. And I remember, like, everyone around me was just like shrugging, like, it's always been a recession here, so. That is that. Night eats day. What more is there to know of attrition? This is what drove us to learn how to drive at 14 years old, four boys and a Honda, cheap talk and already better than ourselves of yesterday. The silver finger on the dashboard said empty. Liar. Where we come from, empty means dead. And what still moves cannot be empty. By 16, we rolled through the streets, blazing music, till it can no longer drown out the engine of our stomachs thumping. 18, we figured it out in our marrow, knew no bowl would be passed our way. We eat only by the suppleness of iron, whatever held us before now oxidized, cruising. We mouth the frenzy to the pedestrian, say it with me, say it until you tremble. Night eats day, always. What the night touches is carcass. My brother feeds his brother to his enemy because of the night. I've seen it, hollow, delicious. We were Pyrex puppies at 19, nourished on hard light, swollen like the fortunate, drifting through the glossy night with a town crier's bass in our voice. We screamed at people, crossing at the lights as we laughed at our 14-year-old selves. Say it with me until you tremble. When you get tired of running from danger, you become the danger. When you get tired of sucking on the void, when you get tired, you become. I was talking about my dad earlier, wasn't I? So I'm a Manchester United supporter, and it's because my dad, most of my household, my three sisters and my brother, my mum, support Arsenal, but it was just my dad. I didn't want him to be alone, so I joined him. I have a thing for the underdog. Patrilineal, this one's called. My father lives with his head inside of a blood orange. He is unassuming in frame, would tell me of the fathers who came before me, how his father died after he touched his father's beard. this is one of two things I know of my forefathers. When he would beat me, I would study him in action, belt swinging like a skipping rope from his shoulder to my arm, my back, buttocks, belly. He would beat the part of himself in me, beating some unhatched omen away, and I performed sobbing to appease his urge to exercise. My mother and siblings are Arsenal fans. It's only I who chose Man United, my father's club. I hope that he would see me in the way a teammate sees another on the grass. At dinner, it is always a winter night, and we serve portions of our faces, our brown eyes, prickly, gorgeous, and we speak only of matches and the word. Once, when there was no football, to survive the silence, I told him I dreamt a prophecy and began to prophesy every unescaped thing in his throat, things that made him afraid of him and me for knowing and speaking it out into the world. And when I could no longer say anything, I coughed up an half-eaten eyeball and told him it was just my hay fever playing up. Over the years, my dad has really started to call me and sort of reach out to just chat. It feels so alien to me. In a way, I'm very annoyed about that, because I feel like I made peace with the fact that we was never gonna have that relationship. And then now he wants it, and now it's on me. And I know I'm gonna regret it if he goes away, and I haven't, but I don't know how, because I've reside and taught myself to just it's not a therapy session. It's Concrete 3. Concrete is the lining of the womb that holds boys to their mothers. When Edwin took a blade, Concrete is the lining of the womb that holds boys with their mothers. When Edwin took a blade to the gut, bled out like a stream running back to its brook, concrete held him soft as a meadow might a lamb, so his death looked like a birthing. We who did not know how to weep raged into the night like the ambulance that came to lift the empty body. His mother asked for the sirens to be turned off lest they disturb her resting boy. That night, we went to chew on a pitchfork of war so that our grief, as if it was a rotting tooth, could be plucked out. Cool, I'll read one more. The Watcher. I really like this. I was obsessed with this song called Strata by a guy called Jesse James Solomon. So this is taking his structure and rewriting it. And also, Dante's Inferno is actually one of the primary books that had such an impact in me as a writer. That and, of course, T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland. So they all kind of find themselves back into this. I see the painting, I see a young me, I see the foxes, they eat a bagel, look through the window, I see the frost leaves, I see the bronze tips, I see the police, doing a strip search, the sun is hiding, I see the moonlight, coming to save them, a field of pavement, crying canaries, I heard it's bad luck, I see the chaos, it could be Rembrandt, could be Renaissance, Ethiopian, iconography, I see the faces, praying for daybreak, I want to help them. I'm just a watcher, sat on a bus seat, led by a stranger. I want to help these epoch of brief things. Their tears are seeping into the canvas, souls of descendants, heart of a rich man, wounded and bleeding. Could be a mistake, smudge of the oil. Is it graffito? Say it's graffiti. The night is teething, because I can feel it, knowing my eyeballs. So now I listen and hear the painting. And hear a trumpet, and hear a trumpet, and hear a trumpet, the final trumpet.